Marble which makes a temple. It is the chanting of the holy name by the devotees which makes a temple.
Management means to manage in a way so that hearing and chanting can go on properly. That is the essence.
Prabhupada said the Vaikuntha atmosphere is where every devotee thinks that everyone else is better than me. Everyone is the master, I am the servant.
Give people Krishna consciousness, and when there are enough people, as a necessity arises, then automatically things will manifest.
If the devotees are satisfied, then automatically in the future the project will come nicely.
The most about this temple are the devotees, as the life and soul of our temple.
What I like about the devotees is the mood, the atmosphere, where all the devotees are so loving, inspiring.
The association among devotees, it is so very welcoming. It's so very pleasing. I feel like, you know, I'm at home.
The unity which is there between the devotees and the relationship between the devotees here, you feel like they are one family. Anyone who comes here, even he comes for the first time, he just is taken in as a family member.
If you please the devotees, you please Krishna. This is our basic understanding.
Best thing I like about this temple is that it's a very, very warm place. It welcomes all newcomers with open arms.
I can see a lotus feet.
And anybody who comes to this temple is straight away transformed because of the Harinam, constant Harinam that is going on here.
Of course, the deities are very beautiful, our devotees are very wonderful, but it is the spirit of the service which is attracting to the heart.
Is trying really to put themselves last and all other devotees first, and really trying to create an atmosphere where I am the servant, you are Prabhu. Then the society will flourish with Krishna consciousness. If we want to create Vaikuntha, there's no other way except to promote this consciousness in the hearts of the devotees.
Let's put that up, totally.
Yeah, because you're not representing anyone but yourself.
That's yeah.
No, you say your beliefs and say how you spent time with them and you learned a lot.
Yeah,
Tell us about you.
Wait a minute, I should ask him a question. So what do you believe, AJ?
What do I believe? Seeing things in a spiritual perspective is seeing things as fundamentally as possible. I think religion is a personal thing, and you develop a personal religion within you. The fact you exist in itself seems simple proof that there is a creator. So coming to this place was another big step in understanding a spiritual perspective from another culture. that might have a lot of answers to the questions I have. So I was very happy to get to India and do this story. It was made for me. It's definitely a different world. I lived with these guys for a month and really absorbed their lifestyle and the way they understood things.
One of the most prominent things which I found in this beautiful temple here is how wonderfully the devotees here are being trained up to respect each other as Vaishnavas.
The most important thing is to learn is to how to serve Krishna through the devotees. Serve the devotees, that is the most important thing you have learned.
If devotees feel protected, if they have faith in their leadership, if they have intimate relationships with their peers, they'll be satisfied.
Tell me about the deeper meaning behind what you're doing.
Actually, I'm not so exalted, you know, so I'm doing it for Radha and Krishna. But I know that if I do this, it's for my purification. I will purify my consciousness slowly and slowly. Cleaning the temple or cleaning Dita room means cleaning of the heart. So if we clean the temple of Krishna, then our heart will be clean. So in that consciousness, I am trying to serve Krishna, Radha and Krishna.
Action, Guruji.
How this guy in action?
He's in action, Guruji. Just see, people who are in action, take their... See, some kids...
Can you tell me what they're doing?
Maha cleaning is going on. And this done by Brahmacharis exclusively.
5:30 we have the Mangal Arati. From 4:30 to 5 is temple cleaning. And every Brahmachari in the temple, including the temple president, is in the schedule once a week. Everyone in the temple must do it. Sweep the floor. You do it, and that inspires.
We started this community with the idea that brahmacharis and householders should be staying in the way that they are servants of each other.
The Maharajas trained us in such a way that there is very mellow relationships between brahmacharis and grihasthas.
We found that it's so very, very important to create a family environment in which every single devotee really feels loved and appreciated.
Maharaj personally told the leaders that if anybody is found to give a gender-based class, making derogatory remarks about women or about household life, he should not be allowed to stay in the ashram.
Association is intensely powerful. I think association works at such a subconscious level that just being around spiritual people, you naturally rise, you naturally live, communicate, and you naturally respond at a higher level.
At the beginning it was difficult.
The brahmacharis would feel that the grihasthas are in maya, and the grihasthas would see the brahmacharis as kind of bumps, puffed up, and that was the situation.
Later, one grihastha godmother revealed to me that in one meeting Maharaj told them that it's my fault and give me some time and I will try to rectify the situation.
When he would meet the brahmacharis, he would glorify the grihasthas. He would say that, see, these people, in spite of the fact that they are working, still they are contributing to the mission.
And then he told the householders in their meetings that unless you respect the renounced order of life, especially the sannyasis and the brahmacharis, you won't be able to make any progress.
So basically what developed was the mutual respect for each other. Then there was a very sweet, nice relationship.
In the temple here, I like the relationship that devotees have amongst each other. Actually, we've been hearing philosophy. Philosophy seems dry if it is not able to be applied. Like here we are taught how to apply the philosophy and be together lovingly.
He always tells us to remember this verse of Lord Chaitanya, Trinadapi Sunechana, Tarurapi Sahishana, Amanina Manadena Kirtanya Sadhari.
One should be more humble than a blade of grass, more tolerant than a tree, ready to offer all respect to others and expect none in return. In this way we can chant the holy name of the Lord constantly.
It didn't happen in a day or two.
Humble beginning, it was a small room of 8 feet by 8 feet.
We had a simple temple. And whatever money we had, we would use it. And whatever we didn't have, we just lived very simple. Because we wanted to somehow or other put all our energies in changing people's hearts.
Prabhupada, it seems, in 1971, had told Shyam Sundar Prabhu, just when they were at Chowpatty, that we must have a preaching center right here. And it seems that it was his desire which was getting fulfilled by Krishna's mercy.
But it wasn't the typical temple, it wasn't planned. This was actually, later on realized that this was actually a temple that started from just a few men in one room. Through dedication, through preaching, they expanded and they kind of pervaded throughout this whole complex. It's a kind of conglomeration of different buildings. It connected this other building with that building with a bridge, and it connected this other building, this other part of this other complex with some stairs. Kind of a network of like bridges and stairs trying to make this temple actually whole. It reminded me of Chutes and Ladders, that game. Is it Chutes and Ladders here? You know that game? Now there's hundreds of people running through in and out.
The building itself is almost 100 years old. Since I have come here in 1987, to this day, I don't remember a single day when there was no repair or renovation or construction going on. It's an endless process. By now, we have replaced almost every bit of the whole building. There's very little left of the original in it. This reminds me of a joke. You must have heard about these Laurel and Hardy. Hardy was wearing a suit. And it was mostly dark, but in a corner there was a small blue patch. So Laurel asked him, "Hardy, how come you put a blue patch on it?" He says, "That's not a patch, that is the original suit. That is all that is left of the original suit. The rest is all patches." The same with our temple.
From temple side, we go down the stairs. And we enter cyber hell. Cyber hell is a whole other world that's existing. Somehow or other cohabitating with the Hare Krishna.
Your name? Sarup. Yeah.
There's a lot of excitement. Indians, a lot of Indian youth are completely into the whole fad of Western life, and they're really ignoring their culture.
Tell me what you're doing.
Actually, I'm doing making a video about the temple here.
So, go in the temple, right? What is
right
this?
Now, Western society and Western lifestyle is pervading India.
Is it alright if I just get a shot of you guys here?
It's a competition with your mind. You're trying to be as close to your soul as possible. But you're kind of stuck with this consciousness that has been affected by your surroundings and by society. School can do that, media, fashion, the things you wear. You choose them, but from some other drive, some other impulse.
What is this?
Since you're here, I thought maybe you'd speak about
being
near the temple.
I don't know anything about the temple.
You don't know anything about the temple. What do most people do here?
Just emailing, chatting, that's it.
How come I'm here, I see all these links for strange sites.
Oh. I'm busy here. Yeah. Come on, yeah.
So you've never been to any of the programs at the temple there?
You
take part in
them? Never. Well, I'm thinking to take part on Janmashtami. It's coming very near, right? Sunday, no?
Where? You're going to take part there?
I'm not sure.
So you're competing with all those distractions and all those influences. So basically what you need to do is really zone away from those.
Minutes before the conch shell is blown, everyone should be in the temple, and anyone who is even few seconds late has to write down during japa time 108 mahamantras. The leaders also do it. They are late, they also do it. Then they see that it's important.
It was amazing to see this dynamic of discipline and the dedication that people have to really live by truth and to really live under the awareness that God's conscious of you.
Association is so sweet. These devotees are so wonderful. It's a great joy to get up together, come into the temple, pay your obeisances, sign in that yes, I'm here on time for Mangalarti, and then everyone coming together and chanting.
Devotees come together to chant the holy name. There's a very, very deep experience of Krishna consciousness.
Right now, the standard, it's unimaginable. Even I couldn't imagine that all of us chant within the temple hall. No one goes out. And whoever goes out has a specific service and he goes out. And we sit in circles from 5:45 to 7:15.
All the beauty, all the mercy, and all the sweetness of the Supreme Truth is contained within the sound of the name. That name cleanses our heart, purifies our mind, and awakens the natural love within us.
India, that I never became a regular practicing doctor. I rather became a devotee. I would be a killer doctor. So I never did any regular practice in that sense, other than the period of internship. Just for 1 or 2 months, I did something. So that is a requirement for joining the temple. You should have some work experience.
Initially, like anyone comes, most welcome. It was like that, and it did go on for some time. One fellow just walked away with 17,000 rupees after staying for 1.5 months. We didn't ask his background, just saying that, oh no, he's come. Many instances.
The unique situation about this temple is that the brahmacharis are not involved in fundraising at all.
If you are not supposed to earn a single cent or a single paisa, then what reason can you give that you don't want to study?
Guru told or Prabhupada said, because there are so many people, they will convince you of so many things. You are making a profound statement, you should substantiate it by scriptural evidence.
Just the fact that you're on a spiritual path means that you have care for yourself. The structure they live by works for them. It keeps them dedicated, it keeps them focused and honest and beautiful.
This is Baladev Prabhu, and he's a great scholar, as you can see. Even though he's sick, he's been immersed in Srimad Bhagavatam all day long.
You're wasting your time.
Really speaking, devotees are so easy to please. What do they need?
The brahmacharis have been living so simply. They never ask anything. Generally, they are so austere in their own lifestyle. They take on so much of the pressures. They live in such austere condition, and they're so very happy.
From day one, our policy is that anyone who comes to the temple should never be approached for making a donation.
People ask us, is there any membership? We said yes, membership is becoming serious.
We would rather preach to him, we would tell him about chanting the holy name, we could give him a book, but never ask for a donation.
When the first time when I came here, it was something, you know, extraordinary. I feel like home very much.
Many people do get put off, they feel that as soon as they come, that we only see the dollar signs. It is not actually the right perception, but it is a perception. So we have studiously avoided that.
Maintenance of the temple and the fundraising is done by the congregation devotees, the householders.
There is nowhere I've been that I've had this kind of feeling, which I am feeling here.
I believe that the greatest fundraising is to make people really feel in their hearts that the temple is their home. It's the place where they meet their expanded spiritual family. They want their temple to flourish. And therefore, not only funds, but they'll give their lives. That type of preaching has a great future.
Consciousness in her family to bring about stability. We take the roles of famous leaders, women leaders, like from our scriptures, like Kunti Mataji, Draupadi Mataji, Gandhari Mataji, their chastity and how they lived their lives, because there is so much of propaganda for women in this modern environment where they are sort of forced to lead unhealthy lives, and unless she knows what is expected of her, what is Vedic culture, she will not be able to fulfill that vision. There is bound to be some friction, so we teach them to have loving relationship with each other.
We all love to call our best friend, but we have to enhance our relationship with everybody.
We teach them to learn to tolerate one another's weaknesses, to live in very great harmonious feelings, and to work as a group together.
Is he here? Please come forward. They have now decided to enter Grihastha Ashram and help each other in dedicating their lives to the mission of Srila Prabhupada. We request all the Vaishnavas here to kindly pray to Sri Radha Gopinath by loudly chanting,
Hare Krishna!
So it is a very guided and a convenient and a confidential approach whereby we act purely as a facilitator. The decision is always left to the individual boy and the girl and to their parents.
If somebody joins as a brahmachari, naturally the congregation loses a member and it's the ashram's gain. And if he leaves the ashram, then he should not leave Krishna consciousness. It should be the congregation's gain. So either one of the parties should gain. There should be no loss to anyone.
In my eyes, I feel that my husband is soon going to become a devotee and we'll both be Krishna conscious and we'll have Krishna conscious children and influence the whole world to become Krishna conscious.
I'm learning how to be a nice devotee.
I've learned how to love here. I joined when I was a student and I was in great trouble. But as soon as I joined Krishna consciousness, as soon as I made friends here in this temple, I've become very, very happy.
How do you see your future in spiritual life?
Extremely bright and fantastic.
Wonderful.
At Radha Gopinath Temple, we're really striving to create whatever programs, projects possible so that each and every devotee, whoever they may be, will feel cared for, appreciated, and spiritually inspired.
One of the main impressions I got when I came back was the shallow depth that there is in our daily communication, and that we fail to remind each other about the deeper things in life.
All of us, even we need some attention, some kind of appreciation.
In a large growing congregation, sometimes people just feel lost. There's no one to talk to, there's no one to, relate to.
Generally, there's a tendency we preach, and the moment he comes, all right, he's one of us, now preach other, but he's neglected. He's already a devotee.
So here, it's just like you go to your house and the mother and the father is there to welcome you. So the moment you see a counselor, you feel you're the shelter of some senior Vaishnava.
Within this counselor board, there are certain specific committees. For example, there is one committee about health. There's one committee which will try and find a job if some devotee has some financial problems, if some devotee has some problem about accommodation, about his living quarters.
They want to surrender. You ask them to collect funds, you ask them to distribute books, you ask them to worship the deities, and they're enlivened to do so. But if there is not that family spirit, if there is not that faith, then it's very difficult to manage a temple.
Dedicating yourself towards a spiritual life, there's a lot of things you go through mentally, of course, and so there's a system there that is there to counsel you through your problems.
A devotee will not be able to pursue spiritual life till he is mentally stable, is physically very comfortable, and emotionally also is very strong. Maharaj said one thing. He said, unless until you are a good listener, you cannot be a counselor. Because people want to pour out their heart.
Many of them have problems, not just spiritual problems. Whether they change a job, they get married, they have problems in their family, marital problems. All these are there, and whom do they turn to?
The relation between the counselor and the counselee is not restricted to the meetings. It's more than the meeting.
In lectures, we hear so much philosophy, but they are practically guiding us how to use this philosophy in our practical lives.
So initially, we were about maybe 5 or 6 counselors. And today, we are 35 counselors.
You need someone who can guide you and who can assess you how your spiritual life is progressing.
In college it was a bit difficult because I was newly introduced that time for Krishna consciousness. But now the young college girls, we are better able to guide them.
Maharaj has been stressing very much that wives are equally counselors. So wives play a very, very crucial stabilizing force.
The system itself has evolved. It has gradually evolved according to the needs of the time. The representation of the brahmacharis is by the presidents who are there, and all the members of the congregation are represented through their counselors.
So the counselor keeps track of all his counselees, guides them, nourishes them, cares for them, and this way it's a, like a small family in a bigger family.
There was a board made of temple presidents. So you have someone, you know, with equal to relate to. Otherwise everyone is going like this, you know, and you are feeling hollow inside.
There are five presidents who take turns by rotation, and for a specified period of time, one of them is the executive president.
So this kind of a rotation helps. You know, you can just watch some relaxation time for you also. Haribol?
I got you guys.
Not that you are completely off, but the light is not on you completely. You can just off the stage a little, you know, be yourself a little.
When devotees learn to have very, very healthy Krishna conscious relationships with one another, based on the spirit of servitude, it creates a culture of real love and trust.
We need to change our landscape. We need to improve the quality of life. Rhythm signifies many things, universally and even personally, with your heart, with your breathing. The rhythm of waves and cycles of wind. There's so much rhythm in life that this falls into that rhythmic beauty, that a community develops rhythm. You can see that. I actually pulled back and just stood and saw everybody doing their own thing, but at the same time connected with each other. And so daily life becomes beautiful. Talk about God. Who is God? I'm on a spiritual journey and I don't want to get lost, basically.
What is real religion? What is the real meaning and purpose of my life in this world? What is the meaning of the world, the universe?
I feel that there is a beauty in life because it's manifested from God. I believe there is a God here and that our very existence is a miracle.
When I was about 19 years old, I decided I have to search for the truth. We got on an airplane, very, very inexpensive flight to Europe. While traveling Europe, I was going to various churches, cathedrals, synagogues. We would go on the road and hitchhike, and whoever picked us up, they would say, "Where are you going?" And we would say, "Where are you going?" And wherever they said they were going, we felt that that's where God wants us to go.
I've asked myself a lot of questions, and I realize that's the first step right there. Asking yourself a question and searching, and you'll find answers that will reveal more and more things.
From Greece, I went to Turkey, then went through Iran, then through Afghanistan, then Pakistan, and after many months came to India. During my travels, I lived with yogis, sometimes in caves, Tibetan Buddhists, in Bodh Gaya, the birthplace of Buddha. I lived with Zen Buddhists and Burmese Buddhists and learned meditations. I also lived with worshippers of Lord Shiva of the Hindu faith, and they very affectionately revealed their their inner hearts to me and tried to give me as much as they could. And I gratefully received it.
And he's about to rock some bhajans right now. Four fours. No, it's one, two. It's one sitting on. Sarvasvato ma charane bodhiya.
Now that I have surrendered all that I possess unto your lotus feet. Sarvasvato ma charane samiya.
After speaking or after listening to him, he is definitely a master of spirit. What brings me to discovering truth is some of the deep sorrows I have in my heart. So there's this fright that sometimes drives you to find answers of what's wrong. And that's when you either close down or you search, you get that strength, and you go for answers. Rather than just be happy in your everyday life with those small short-term enjoyments that keep your mind so busy that you never address what's most personal to you, what's most important to you. I want to understand my existence and make sense of this world, because if there is a path to God, I want to get on that.
We came from colleges. We were preached in colleges. We knew how potent this form of preaching was. And 91-92, Devan Prabhu really started systematic college preaching in medical colleges and also IIT, Indian Institute of Technology. From there we've got so many devotees, Radhesham, Gauranga Prabhu, Paramahans Prabhu, all these devotees. So we concentrated on the professional colleges, medicine, engineering.
Of our preaching is to create an awareness amongst the doctors that apart from creating the body, they also must not neglect that there is a soul within this body.
No intoxication including tea and coffee. No. Nahi. This is not possible. Where in Bhagavad Gita Krishna says, show me. Which verse? Which shloka? I want to see that shloka. Tea, chai nahi, coffee nahi.
And hence they are able to offer better quality service to their patients because they understand that every patient who comes to them is actually a son of God, a part and parcel of Krishna. Survive in such college campuses if there is very strong sangha. So our emphasis is on developing loving relations amongst each other on the basis of Krishna consciousness. In this way we have a very wonderful group of students who are taking great strength in each other's association.
As a blazing fire,
as a blazing fire
turns firewood to ashes.
Turns firewood to ashes.
I'm amazed how many young people come in. That was one thing. I was amazed how much youth are inquiring about God. Home programs are the most interesting there, because there you see community become family. Family have made their home a temple. And these people treat each other like brothers and sisters.
Try to make our home into a sacred place. Krishna, or God, is the proprietor of everything that exists. The proprietor of my body, the proprietor of my family, the proprietor of my home. And to acknowledge that by offering our home to God.
Now you are doing something good, and getting good, maybe in this lifetime you may not be able to enjoy that good. So take birth again in your next life to enjoy the pending good which you did.
Balancing with one and the other, are they differentiating with one
another? Yes. Good question. Do pious activities and impious activities nullify each other, balance each other? That means I might go and drink a glass of beer and come back here and chant the Hare Krishna. And wonderful, you know, the holy name purifies. So I am also purified. The real knowledge means to see something in relationship to everything. Then that knowledge is complete knowledge. That is what Srila Prabhupada calls as transcendental.
Enthusiasm means to follow the four regulative principles very strictly in our life. If you have this strong sadhana and if you keep yourself very strong, then what will happen is that it will inspire your spiritual master to fight. Gives him more inspiration. But if you become a little bit lax, then what happens? That power is not there. So it's everything is a collective effort.
Sadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda
Shiva Sadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda
Hare Krishna Hare Krishna
Hare Krishna Hare Krishna
Krishna Hare Hare
Krishna Krishna Hare Hare
Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Hare
Hare
Let me go.
I was 19, but I looked about 15, living like a sadhu with matted hair and sadhu robes with a begging pot. While I was traveling, I happened to come through Bombay. And there, while walking down the street, I saw a big sign saying Hare Krishna. There was a big, big tent in the evening. 30,000 people, approximately, came into that tent. And then the spiritual master of this religious movement came to the stage. So for 2 weeks, I would come to all of his lectures and hear him very carefully.
So, if you kindly become Krishna conscious and chant...
His name was A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada.
The whole world will follow you.
Lord Krishna is the supreme cause of all causes.
Relationship with them, I would say, has played the major role in developing this project.
Everybody had so much control, so much focus, so much perfection. I realized these guys are warriors. They're fighting against material desires. They're fighting against illusion.
The faith came from seeing the dedication and purity of the leader.
Srila Prabhupada taught us that the ultimate goal of life is to understand our relationship with the personality of Godhead. And to revive this love of God is the ultimate fulfillment of all the heart's desires. His depth of knowledge, his compassion, his realization convinced my heart. I came to the conclusion that this saintly person is the embodiment of the essence of all of the spiritual principles that I have learned through all the teachers, through all the paths throughout the world.
I think it's so wonderful that any discussion in this time, when leaders are talking about developing spiritual community, that inevitably this community is mentioned. So I also come as a thief to come to steal some of the energy here, some of the potency. Take some, then I'll run away and distribute it someplace.
If the principles are emphasized anywhere, there will be wonderful results. I strongly believe that.
in the long run at least all the devotees are, you know, remain Krishna conscious. That's the essence. More than the things being done, we want the devotees to stay for the rest of their life as a devotee, continue to remain a devotee. That is the real thing. Side by side, we preach.
If the community gets that kind of support and vision, they surely will respond. That's what their main need is. So if that need is catered to, we can see even more, even better results any other place.
What I have to say in conclusion, somehow I am very fortunate that Krishna and Prabhupada have accepted me. And I pray to Krishna that I remain in Krishna consciousness by His mercy and continue to serve the devotees.
So our goal in Krishna consciousness preaching is to somehow or other deal with every devotee in such a way that as far as possible we can assure that they will remain in Srila Prabhupada's movement for the rest of their lives with faith, trust, and a very, very great enthusiasm to hear and chant the glories of the Lord. If we try for that, Krishna can empower us, and He will empower us, because it's what Prabhupada wanted.
Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna.
we are trying our very best.
Slowly, we're getting there.
It felt like a different world.